Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Unnatural Exposure by Patricia Cornwell, narrated by C.J. Critt. This work is copyrighted 1997 by Patricia Daniels Cornwell. This recording is copyrighted 2002 by Recorded Books. The book begins with the following quote from Revelation chapter 21, verse 9. And there came unto me one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials full of the seven last plagues. And now, Unnatural Exposure.
Chapter 1. Night fell clean and cold in Dublin, and wind moaned beyond my room, as if a million pipes played the air. Gusts shook old window panes and sounded like spirits rushing past, as I rearranged pillows one more time, finally resting on my back in a snarl of Irish linen. But sleep wouldn't touch me, and images from the day returned. I saw bodies without limbs or heads, and sat up, sweating. I switched on lamps, and the Shelbourne Hotel was suddenly around me in a warm glow of rich old woods and deep red plaids. I put on a robe, my eyes lingering on the phone by my fitfully slept-in bed. It was almost 2 a.m. In Richmond, Virginia, it would be 5 hours earlier, and Pete Marino, commander of the City Police Department's homicide squad, should be up. He was probably watching TV, smoking, eating something bad for him, unless he was on the street. I dialed his number, and he grabbed the phone as if he were right next to it.
Trick or treat!
He was loudly on his way to being drunk. You're a little early, I said, already regretting the call. By a couple of weeks.
Doc?
He paused in confusion.
That you? You back in Richmond?
Still in Dublin. What's all the commotion?
Just some of us guys with faces so ugly we don't need masks. So every day is Halloween. Hey, Bubba's bluffing,
he yelled out.
You always think everybody's bluffing, a voice fired back. It's from being a detective too long.
What are you talking about? Marino can't even detect his own B.O. Laughter in the background was loud as the drunk, derisive comments continued.
We're playing poker, Marino said to me. What the hell time is it there?
You don't want to know, I answered. I've got some unsettling news, but it doesn't sound like we should get into it now.
No, hold on. Let me just move the phone. Shit, I hate the way the cord gets twisted. You know what I mean? God damn it.
I could hear his heavy footsteps and a chair scraping.
Okay, Doc. So, what the hell's going on?
I spent most of today discussing the landfill cases with the state pathologist. Marino, I'm increasingly suspicious that Ireland's serial dismemberments are the work of the same individual we're dealing with in Virginia. He raised his voice.
You guys hold it down in there!
I could hear him moving farther away from his pals as I rearranged the duvet around me. I reached for the last few sips of black bush I had carried to bed. Dr. Foley worked the 5 Dublin cases, I went on. I've reviewed all of them. Torsos. Spines cut horizontally through the caudal aspect of the 5th cervical vertebral body. Arms and legs severed through the joints, which is unusual, as I've pointed out before. Victims are a racial mix, estimated ages between 18 and 35. All are unidentified and signed out as homicides by unspecified means. In each case, heads and limbs were never found, the remains discovered in privately owned landfills.
Damn, if that don't sound familiar, he said.
There are other details, but yes, the parallels are profound.
So maybe the squirrel's in the U.S. now, he said. Guess it's a damn good thing you went over there after all.
He certainly hadn't thought so at first. No one really had. I was the chief medical examiner of Virginia, and when the Royal College of Surgeons had invited me to give a series of lectures at Trinity's Medical School, I couldn't pass up an opportunity to investigate the Dublin crimes. Marino had thought it a waste of time, while the FBI had assumed the value of the research would prove to be little more than statistical. Doubts were understandable. The homicides in Ireland were more than 10 years old, and as was true in the Virginia cases, there was so little to go on. We didn't have fingerprints, dentition, sinus configurations, or witnesses for identification. We didn't have biological samples from people missing to compare to the victim's DNA. We didn't know the means of death. Therefore, it was very difficult to say much about the killer, except that I believed he was experienced with a meat saw, and quite possibly used one in his profession, or had at one time. The last case in Ireland that we know of was a decade ago, I was saying to Marino over the line. In the past 2 years, we've had 4 in Virginia.
So you're thinking he stopped for 8 years?
He said.
Why? He was in prison, maybe, for some other crime?
I don't know. He may have been killing someplace else and the cases haven't been connected, I replied, as wind made unearthly sounds.
There's those serial cases in South Africa, he thickly thought out loud. In Florence, Germany, Russia, Australia. Shit! Now that you think of it, they're friggin' everywhere. Hey!
He put his hand over the phone.
Smoke your own damn cigarettes. What do you think this is, friggin' welfare?
Male voices were rowdy in the background, and someone had put on Randy Travis. Sounds like you're having fun, I dryly said. Please don't invite me next year, either.
Bunch of animals, he mumbled.
Don't ask me why I do this. Every time they drink me out of house, home, cheat at cards.
The M.O. in these cases is very distinctive. My tone was meant to sober.
Okay, he said. So if this guy started in Dublin, maybe we're looking for someone Irish. I think you should hurry back home, he belched. Sounds like we need to go to Quantico and get on this. You told Benton yet?
Benton Wesley headed the FBI's Child Abduction Serial Killer Unit, or CASCU, for which both Marino and I were consultants. I haven't had a chance to tell him yet, I replied hesitantly. Maybe you can give him a heads up. I'll get home as soon as I can.
Tomorrow would be good.
I'm not finished with the lecture series here, I said.
Ain't a place in the world that don't want you to lecture. You could probably do that and nothing else, he said, and I knew he was about to dig into me.
We export our violence to other countries, I said. The least we can do is teach them what we know, what we've learned from years of working these crimes.
Lectures ain't why you're staying in the land of leprechauns, Doc, he interrupted as a flip-top popped. It ain't why, and you know it.
Marino, I warned, don't do this. But he kept on.
Ever since Wesley's divorce, you found one reason or another to skip along the yellow brick road right on out of town. And you don't want to come home now, I can tell from the way you sound, because you don't want the deal. Take a look at your hand and take your chances. Let me tell you, comes a time when you gotta call a fold.
Point taken. I was gentle as I cut off his besotted good intentions. Marino, don't stay up all night. The coroner's office was at number 3 Store Street, across from the Custom House and Central Bus Station, near docks and the River Liffey. The brick building was small and old. The alleyway leading to the back, barred by a heavy black gate with morgue painted across it in bold white letters. Climbing steps to the Georgian entrance, I rang the bell and waited in mist. It was cool this Tuesday morning, trees beginning to look like fall. I could feel my lack of sleep. My eyes burned, my head was dull, and I was unsettled by what Marino had said before I had almost hung up on him. "Hello," the administrator cheerfully let me in. "How are we this morning, Dr. Scarpetta?" His name was Jimmy Shaw, and he was very young and Irish, with hair as fiery as copper ivy and eyes as blue as sky. "I've been better," I confessed. "Well, I was just boiling tea," he said, shutting us inside a narrow, dimly lit hallway, which we followed to his office. "Sounds like you could use a cup." "That would be lovely, Jimmy," I said. "As for the good doctor, she should be finishing up an inquest." He glanced at his watch as we entered his cluttered small space. "She should be out in no time." His desk was dominated by a large coroner's inquiries book, black and bound in heavy leather, and he had been reading a biography of Steve McQueen and eating toast before I arrived. Momentarily, he was setting a mug of tea within my reach, not asking how I took it, for by now he knew. "A little toast with jam," he asked, as he did every morning. "I ate at the hotel, thanks." I gave the same reply as he sat behind his desk. "Never stops me from eating again," he smiled, slipping on glasses. "I'll just go over your schedule then. You lecture at 11 this morning, then again at 1 p.m., both at the college, in the old pathology building. I should expect about 75 students for each, but there could be more. I don't know. You're awfully popular over here, Dr. K. Scarpetta," he cheerfully said. "Or maybe it's just that American violence is so exotic to us." "That's rather much like calling a plague exotic," I said. "Well, we can't help but be fascinated by what you see." "And I guess that bothers me," I said in a friendly but ominous way. "Don't be too fascinated." We were interrupted by the phone, which he snapped up with the impatience of one who answers it too often. Listening for a moment, he brusquely said, "Right, right. Well, we can't place an order like that just yet. I'll have to ring you back another time." "I've been wanting computers for years," he complained to me as he hung up. "No bloody money when you're the dog wagged by the socialist tail." "There will never be enough money. Dead men don't vote." "The bloody truth. So what's the topic of the day?" he wanted to know. "Sexual homicide," I replied. "Specifically the role DNA can play." "These dismemberments you're so interested in," he sipped tea. "Do you think they're sexual? I mean, would that be the motivation on the part of whoever would do this?" His eyes were keen with interest. "It's certainly an element," I replied. "But how can you know that when none of the victims has ever been identified? Couldn't it just be someone who kills for sport? Like, say, your Son of Sam, for example." "What Son of Sam did had a sexual element," I said, looking around for my pathologist friend. "Do you know how much longer she might be? I'm afraid I'm in a bit of a hurry." Shaw glanced at his watch again. "You can check. Or I suppose she may have gone on to the morgue. We have a case coming in. A young male, suspected suicide." "I'll see if I can find her." I got up. Off the hallway near the entrance was the coroner's court, where inquests for unnatural deaths were held before a jury. This included industrial and traffic accidents, homicides and suicides, the proceedings in camera, for the press in Ireland wasn't allowed to print many details. I ducked inside a stark, chilly room of varnished benches and naked walls and found several men inside, tucking paperwork into briefcases. "I'm looking for the coroner," I said.
"She slipped out about 20 minutes ago. Believe she had a viewing," one of them said.
I left the building through the back door. Crossing a small parking lot, I headed to the morgue as an old man came out of it. He seemed disoriented, almost stumbling as he looked about, dazed. For an instant, he stared at me as if I held some answer, and my heart hurt for him. No business that had brought him here could possibly be kind. I watched him hurry toward the gate as Dr. Margaret Foley suddenly emerged after him, harried, her graying hair disarrayed.
"My God!" she almost ran into me. "I turned my back for a minute and he's gone."
The man let himself out, the gate flung open wide as he fled. Foley trotted across the parking lot to shut and latch it again. When she got back to me, she was out of breath and almost tripped over a bump in the pavement.
"Kay, you're out and about early," she said.
"A relative?" I asked.
"The father. Left without identifying him, before I could even pull back the sheet. That will foul me up the rest of the day."
She led me inside the small brick morgue with its white porcelain autopsy tables that probably belonged in a medical museum, and old iron stove that heated nothing anymore. The air was refrigerated chilly. Modern equipment non-existent, except for electric autopsy saws. Thin gray light seeped through opaque skylights, barely illuminating the white paper sheet covering a body that a father couldn't bear to see.
"It's always the hardest part," she was saying. "No one should ever have to look at anyone in here."
I followed her into a small storeroom and helped carry out boxes of new syringes, masks, and gloves.
"Strung himself up from the rafters in the barn," she went on as we worked. "Was being treated for a drink problem and depression. More of the same. Unemployment, women, drugs. They hang themselves or jump off bridges."
She glanced at me as we restocked a surgical cart.
"Thank God we don't have guns, especially since I don't have an X-ray machine."
Foley was a slight woman, with old-fashioned thick glasses and a penchant for tweed. We had met years ago at an international forensic science conference in Vienna, when female forensic pathologists were a rare breed, especially overseas. We quickly had become friends.
"Margaret, I'm going to have to head back to the States sooner than I thought," I said, taking a deep breath, looking about, distracted. "I didn't sleep worth a damn last night."
She lit a cigarette, scrutinizing me.
"I can get you copies of whatever you want. How fast do you need them? Photographs may take a few days, but they can be sent."
"I think there is always a sense of urgency when someone like this is on the loose," I said.
"I'm not happy if he's now your problem. And I'd hoped after all these years he had bloody quit."
She irritably tapped an ash, exhaling the strong smoke of British tobacco.
"Let's take a load off for a minute. My shoes are already getting tight from the swelling. It's hell getting old on these bloody hard floors."
The lounge was two squat wooden chairs in a corner, where Foley kept an ashtray on a gurney. She put her feet up on a box and indulged her vice.
"I can never forget those poor people."
She started talking about her serial cases again.
"When the first one came to me, I thought it was the IRA. Never seen people torn asunder like that except in bombings."
I was reminded of Mark, in a way I didn't want to be, and my thoughts drifted to him when he was alive and we were in love. Suddenly, he was in my mind,
smiling with eyes full of a mischievous light that became electric when he laughed and teased. There had been a lot of that in law school at Georgetown. Fun and fights and staying up all night, our hunger for each other impossible to appease. Over time, we married other people, divorced, and tried again. He was my leitmotif, here, gone, then back on the phone, or at my door to break my heart and wreck my bed. I could not banish him. It still didn't seem possible that a bombing in a London train station would finally bring the tempest of our relationship to an end. I didn't imagine him dead. I couldn't envision it, for there was no last image that might grant peace. I had never seen his body, had fled from any chance, just like the old Dubliner who couldn't view his son. I realized Foley was saying something to me. "I'm sorry," she repeated, her eyes sad, for she knew my history well. "I didn't mean to bring up something painful. You seem blue enough this morning." "You made an interesting point." I tried to be brave. "I suspect the killer we're looking for is rather much like a bomber. He doesn't care who he kills. His victims are people with no faces or names. They're nothing but symbols of his private evil credo." "Would it bother you terribly if I asked a question about Mark?" she said. "Ask anything you want," I smiled. "You will anyway." "Have you ever gone to where it happened? Visited that place where he died?" "I don't know where it happened," I quickly replied. She looked at me as she smoked. "What I mean is, I don't know where exactly in the train station." I was evasive, almost stuttering. Still, she said nothing, crushing the cigarette beneath her foot. "Actually," I went on, "I don't know that I've been in Victoria at all. Not that particular station, since he died. I don't think I've had reason to take a train from there, or arrive there. Waterloo was the last one I was in, I think." "The one crime scene the great Dr. K. Scarpetta will not visit." She tapped another consulate out of the pack. "Would you like one?" "God knows I would, but I can't." She sighed. "I remember Vienna. All those men and the two of us smoking more than they did." "Probably the reason we smoked so much was all those men," I said. "That may be the cause, but for me, there seems to be no cure. It just goes to show that what we do is unrelated to what we know, and our feelings don't have a brain." She shook out a match. "I've seen smokers' lungs, and I've seen my share of fatty livers. My lungs are better since I quit. I can't vouch for my liver," I said. "I haven't given up whiskey yet." "Don't, for God's sake. You'd be no fun." She paused, adding pointedly, "Course, feelings can be directed, educated, so they don't conspire against us." "I will probably leave tomorrow." I got back to that. "You have to go to London first to change planes." She met my eyes. "Linger there. A day." "Pardon?" "It's unfinished business, Kay. I've felt this for a long time. You need to bury Mark James." "Margaret, what has suddenly prompted this?" I was tripping over words again. "I know when someone is on the run, and you are, just as much as this killer is." "Now, that's a comforting thing to say," I replied, and I didn't want to have this conversation. But she wasn't going to let me escape this time. "For very different reasons and very similar reasons,
He's evil. You're not. But neither of you wants to be caught.
She had gotten to me and could tell. And just who or what is trying to catch me, in your opinion? My tone was light, but I felt the threat of tears. At this stage, I expect it's Bent and Wesley. I stared off, past the gurney and its protruding pale foot tied with a tag. Light from above shifted by degrees as clouds moved over the sun, and the smell of death in tile and stone went back 100 years.
Kay, what do you want to do?
She asked kindly as I wiped my eyes.
He wants to marry me, I said.
I flew home to Richmond, and days became weeks with weather getting cold. Mornings were glazed with frost, and evenings I spent in front of the fire, thinking and fretting. So much was unresolved and silent, and I coped the way I always did, working my way deeper into the labyrinth of my profession, until I couldn't find a way out. It was making my secretary crazy.
Dr. Scarpetta?
She called out my name, her footsteps loud and brisk along the tile floor in the autopsy suite.
In here,
I answered over running water. It was October 30th. I was in the morgue locker room, washing up with antibacterial soap.
Where have you been?
Rose asked as she walked in. Working on a brain. The sudden death from the other day? She was holding my calendar and flipping pages. Her gray hair was neatly pinned back, and she was dressed in a dark red suit that seemed appropriate for her mood. Rose was deeply angry with me, and had been since I had left for Dublin without saying goodbye. Then I forgot her birthday when I got back. I turned off the water and dried my hands. Swelling, with widening of the gyri, narrowing of the sulci, all good for ischemic encephalopathy brought on by his profound systemic hypotension, I cited.
I've been trying to find you, she said with strained patience.
What did I do this time? I threw up my hands.
You were supposed to have lunch at the Skull and Bones with John.
Oh, God. I groaned as I thought of him and other medical school advisees I had so little time to see.
I reminded you this morning. You forgot him last week, too. He really needs to talk to you about his residency, about the Cleveland Clinic.
I know, I know. I felt awful about it as I looked at my watch.
It's 1:30. Maybe he can come by my office for coffee? You have a deposition at 2, a conference call at 3 about the Norfolk Southern case, a gunshot wound lecture to the Forensic Science Academy at 4, and a meeting at 5 with Investigator Ring from the State Police.
Rose went down the list. I didn't like Ring or his aggressive way of taking over cases. When the second torso had been found, he had inserted himself into the investigation and seemed to think he knew more than the FBI. Ring I can do without, I said shortly. My secretary looked at me for a long moment, water and sponges slapping in the autopsy suite next door.
I'll cancel him, and you can see John instead.
She eyed me over her glasses like a stern headmistress. Then rest. And that's an order. Tomorrow, Dr. Scarpetta, don't come in. Don't you dare let me see you darken the door. I started to protest, and she cut me off.
Don't even think of arguing, she firmly went on. You need a mental health day, a long weekend. I wouldn't say that if I didn't mean it.
She was right, and as I thought about having a day to myself, my spirits lifted.
There's not a thing I can't reschedule, she added. Besides, she smiled, we're having a touch of Indian summer, and it's supposed to be glorious in the 80s with the big blue sky. Leaves are at their peak, poplars an almost perfect yellow. Maples look like they're on fire. Not to mention, it's Halloween. You can carve a pumpkin. I got suit jacket and shoes out of my locker. You should have been a lawyer, I said. Chapter 2. The next day, the weather was just what Rose predicted, and I woke up thrilled. As stores were opening, I set out to stock up for trick-or-treaters and dinner, and I drove far out on Hull Street to my favorite gardening center. Summer plantings had long since faded around my house, and I couldn't bear to see their dead stalks in pots. After lunch, I carried bags of black soil, boxes of plants, and a watering can to my front porch. I opened the door so I could hear Mozart playing inside as I gently tucked pansies into their rich new bed. Bread was rising, homemade stew simmering on the stove, and I smelled garlic and wine and loamy soil as I worked. Marino was coming for dinner, and we were going to hand out chocolate bars to my small, scary neighbors. The world was a good place to live, until 3:35 when my pager vibrated against my waist. "Damn," I exclaimed, as it displayed the number for my answering service. I hurried inside, washed my hands, and reached for the phone. The service gave me a number for a Detective Grigg with the Sussex County Sheriff's Department, and I immediately called. "Grigg?" a man answered in a deep voice. "This is Dr. Scarpetta," I said, as I stared dismally out windows at large terracotta pots on the deck and the dead hibiscus in them.
"Oh, good. Thank you for getting back to me so quick. I'm out here on a cellular phone. Don't want to say much."
He spoke with the rhythm of the old South and took his time. "Where exactly is here?" I asked.
"Atlantic Waste Landfill on Reeves Road, off 460 East. They've turned something up I think you're going to want to take a look at."
"Is this the same sort of thing that has turned up in similar places?" I cryptically asked, as the days seemed to get darker.
"Afraid that's what it's looking like," he said.
"Give me directions, and I'm on my way." I was in dirty khakis and an FBI t-shirt that my niece Lucy had given to me, and didn't have time to change. If I didn't recover the body before dark, it would have to stay where it was until morning, and that was unacceptable. Grabbing my medical bag, I hurried out the door, leaving soil, cabbage plants, and geraniums scattered over the porch. Of course, my black Mercedes was low on gas. I stopped at Amoco first and pumped my own, then was on my way. The drive should have taken an hour, but I sped. Waning light flashed white on the underside of leaves, and rows of corn were brown in farms and gardens. Fields were ruffled green seas of soybeans, and goats grazed unrestrained in the yards of tired homes. Gaudy lightning rods with colored balls tilted from every peak and corner. And I always wondered what lying salesman had hit like a storm and played on fear by preaching more. Soon grain elevators Grigg had told me to look for came into view. I turned on Reeves Road, passing tiny brick homes and trailer courts with pickup trucks and dogs with no collars. Billboards advertised Mountain Dew and the Virginia Diner. And I bumped over railroad tracks, red dust billowing up like smoke from my tires. Ahead,
Buzzards in the road picked at creatures that had been too slow, and it seemed a morbid harbinger. At the entrance of the Atlantic Waste landfill, I slowed my car to a stop and looked out at a moonscape of barren acres where the sun was setting like a planet on fire. Flatbed refuse trucks were sleek and white with polished chrome, crawling along the summit of a growing mountain of trash. Yellow caterpillars were striking scorpions. I sat watching a moiling storm of dust heading away from the landfill, rocking over ruts at a high rate of speed. When it got to me, it was a dirty red Ford Explorer, driven by a young man who felt at home in this place.
"May I help you, ma'am?"
he said in a southern drawl, and he seemed anxious and excited.
"I'm Dr. K. Scarpetta," I replied, displaying the brass shield in its small black wallet that I always pulled at scenes where I didn't know anyone. He studied my credentials. Then his eyes were dark on mine. He was sweating through his denim shirt, hair wet at his neck and temples.
"They said the medical examiner would get here, and for me to watch for him," he said to me.
"Well, that would be me," I blandly replied.
"Oh, yes, ma'am. I didn't mean anything."
His voice trailed off as his eyes wandered over my Mercedes, which was coated in dust so fine and persistent that nothing could keep it out.
"I suggest you leave your car here and ride with me," he added.
I stared up at the landfill, at caterpillars with rampant blades and buckets immobile on the summit. Two unmarked police cars and an ambulance awaited me up where the trouble was, and officers were small figures gathered near the tailgate of a truck smaller than the rest. Near it, someone was poking the ground with a stick, and I got increasingly impatient to get to the body.
"Okay," I said, "let's do it."
Parking my car, I got my medical bag and scene clothes out of the trunk. The young man watched in curious silence as I sat in my driver's seat with the door wide open and pulled on rubber boots, scarred and dull from years of wading in woods and rivers for people murdered and drowned. I covered myself with a big faded denim shirt that I had appropriated from my ex-husband Tony during a marriage that now didn't seem real. Then I climbed inside the Explorer and sheathed my hands in two layers of gloves. I pulled a surgical mask over my head and left it loose around my neck.
"I can't say that I blame you," my driver said. "The smell's pretty rough. I can tell you that."
"It's not the smell," I said. "Microorganisms are what make me worry."
"Gee," he said anxiously. "Maybe I should wear one of those things."
"You shouldn't be getting close enough to have a problem." He made no reply, and I had no doubt that he already had gotten that close. Looking was too much of a temptation for most people to resist. The more gruesome the case, the more this was true.
"I sure am sorry about the dust," he said, as we drove through tangled goldenrod on the rim of a small fire pond populated with ducks. "You can see we put a layer of tire chips everywhere to keep things settled, and a street cleaner sprays it down. But nothing seems to help all that much." He nervously paused before going on. "We do 3,000 tons of trash a day out here."
"From where?" I asked.
"Littleton, North Carolina to Chicago."
"What about Boston?" I asked, for the first four cases were believed to be from as far away as that.
"No, ma'am." He shook his head. "Maybe one of these days. We're so much less per ton down here. $25 compared to $69 in New Jersey, or $80 in New York. Plus, we recycle. test for hazardous waste, collect methane gas from decomposing trash.
What about your hours?
Open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, he said with pride.
And you have a way to track where the trucks come from?
A satellite system that uses a grid. We can at least tell you which trucks would have dumped trash during a certain time period in the area where the body was found.
We splashed through a deep puddle near Portageon's and rocked by a power wash where trucks were being hosed off on their way back out to life's roads and highways.
I can't say we've ever had anything like this, he said. Now, they've had body parts at the shoesmith dump, or at least that's the rumor.
He glanced at me, assuming I would know if such a rumor were true. But I didn't verify what he had just said as the explorer sloshed through mud strewn with rubber chips, the sour stench of decomposing garbage drifting in. My attention was riveted to the small truck I had been watching since I'd gotten here, thoughts racing along 1,000 different tracks.
By the way, my name's Keith Pleasance.
He wiped a hand on his pants and held it out to me.
Pleased to meet you.
My gloved hand shook his at an awkward angle, as men holding handkerchiefs and rags over their noses watched us pull up. There were four of them, gathered around the back of what I now could see was a hydraulic packer, used for emptying dumpsters and compressing the trash. Coles Trucking Company was painted on the door.
That guy poking garbage with a stick is the detective for Sussex, Pleasant said to me.
He was older, in shirt sleeves, wearing a revolver on his hip. I felt I'd seen him somewhere before. Greg, I guessed, referring to the detective I had spoken to on the phone.
That's right.
Sweat was rolling down Pleasant's face, and he was getting more keyed up.
You know, I've never had any dealings with the sheriff's department, never even gotten a speeding ticket around here.
We slowed down to a halt, and I could barely see through the boiling dust. Pleasance grabbed his door handle. Sit tight just a minute, I told him. I waited for dust to settle, looking out the windshield and surveying as I always did when approaching a crime scene. The loader's bucket was frozen midair, the packer beneath it almost full. All around, the landfill was busy and full of diesel sounds. Work stopped only here. For a moment, I watched powerful white trucks roar uphill as cats clawed and grabbed, and compactors crushed the ground with their chopper wheels. The body would be transported by ambulance, and paramedics watched me through dusty windows as they sat in air conditioning, waiting to see what I was going to do. When they saw me fix the surgical mask over my nose and mouth and open my door, they climbed out too. Doors slammed shut. The detective immediately walked to meet me.
Detective Grigg, Sussex Sheriff's Department, he said. I'm the one who called.
Have you been out here the entire time? I asked him.
Since we were notified at approximately 1300 hours. Yes, ma'am. I've been right here to make sure nothing was disturbed.
Excuse me, one of the paramedics said to me. You going to want us right now? Maybe in 15. Someone will come get you, I said, as they wasted no time returning to their ambulance. I'm going to need some room here, I said to everybody else. Feet crunched as people stepped out of the way, revealing what they had been guarding and gawking at. Flesh was unnaturally pale in the dying light of the autumn afternoon. The torso, a hideous stub that had tumbled from a scoop of trash and landed on its back. I thought it was Caucasian, but wasn't sure, and maggots teeming in the genital area made it difficult for me to determine gender at a glance. But I couldn't even say with certainty whether the victim was pre- or post-pubescent. Body fat was abnormally low, ribs protruding beneath flat breasts that may or may not have been female. I squatted close and opened my medical bag. With forceps, I collected maggots into a jar for the entomologist to examine later, and decided upon closer inspection that the victim was, in fact, a woman. She had been decapitated, low on the cervical spine, arms and legs severed. Stumps were dry and dark with age, and I knew right away that there was a difference between this case and the others. This woman had been dismembered by cutting straight through the strong bones of the humerus and femur versus the joints. Getting out a scalpel, I could feel the men staring as I made a half-inch incision on the torso's right side and inserted a long chemical thermometer. I rested a second thermometer on top of my bag. "What are you doing?" asked a man in a plaid shirt and baseball cap who looked like he might get sick. I need the body's temperature to help determine time of death. A core liver temperature is the most accurate, I patiently explained. And I also need to know the temperature out here.
Hot, that's what it is, said another man. So it's a woman, I guess?
It's too soon to say, I replied. Is this your packer?
Yeah.
He was young, with dark eyes and very white teeth, and tattoos on his fingers that I usually associated with people who have been in prison. A sweaty bandana was tied around his head and knotted in back, and he couldn't look at the torso long without averting his gaze.
In the wrong place at the wrong time, he added, shaking his head with hostility. What do you mean?
Grig had his eye on him.
Wasn't from me, I know that,
the driver said, as if it were the most important point he would ever make in his life.
The cat dug it up while I was spreading my load.
Then we don't know when it was dumped here. I scanned faces around me. It was Pleasance who replied.
23 trucks unloaded in this spot since 10 a.m., not counting this one.
He looked at the packer. Why 10 a.m.? I asked, for it seemed like a rather arbitrary time to start counting trucks.
Because that's when we put down the last cover of tire chips. So there's no way it could have been dumped before then,
Pleasance explained, staring at the body.
And in my opinion, it couldn't have been out long anyway. It doesn't exactly look the way you'd expect if it's been run over by a 50-ton compactor with chopper wheels, trucks, or even this loader.
He stared off at other sites where compacted trash was being gouged off trucks as huge tractors crushed and spread. The driver of the packer was getting increasingly agitated and angry.
We got big machines all over the place up here, Pleasance added, and they pretty much never stop.
I looked at the packer and the bright yellow loader with its empty cab. A tatter of black trash bag fluttered from the raised bucket. Where's the driver of the loader? I asked. Pleasance hesitated before answering.
Well, I guess that would be me. We had somebody out sick. I was asked to work on the hill.
Grig moved closer to the loader, looking up at what was left of the trash bag as it moved in the hot, barren air. Tell me what you saw, I said to Pleasance.
Not much. I was unloading him,
He nodded at the driver. And my bucket caught the garbage bag, the one you see there. It tore, and the body fell out to where it is now.
He paused, wiping his face on his sleeve and swatting at flies. But you don't know for sure where this came from, I tried again, while Grig listened, even though he probably had already taken their statements.
I could have dug it up, Pleasance conceded. I'm not saying it's impossible. I just don't think I did.
That's 'cause you don't want to think it, the driver glared at him.
I know what I think.
Pleasance didn't flinch.
The bucket grabbed it off your packer when I was unloading it.
Man, you don't know it came from me, the driver snapped at him.
No, I don't know it for a fact. Makes sense, that's all.
Maybe to you.
The driver's face was menacing.
Believe that will be about enough, boys,
Grig warned, moving close again, his presence reminding them he was big and wore a gun.
You got that right, said the driver. I've had enough of this shit. When can I get out of here? I'm already late. Something like this inconveniences everyone, Grig said to him with a steady look.
Rolling his eyes and muttering profanity, the driver stalked off and lit a cigarette. I removed the thermometer from the body and held it up. The core temperature was 84 degrees, the same as the ambient air. I turned the torso over to see what else was there and noted a curious crop of fluid-filled vesicles over the lower buttocks. As I checked more carefully, I found evidence of others in the area of the shoulders and thighs, at the edges of deep cuts. Double pouch her, I directed. I need the trash bag it came in, including what's caught on the bucket up there. And I want the trash immediately around and under her. Send all of it in. Grig unfolded a 20-gallon trash bag and shook it open. He pulled gloves out of a pocket, squatted, and started grabbing up garbage by the handful while paramedics opened the back of the ambulance. The driver of the Packer was leaning against his cab, and I could feel his fury like heat. Where was your Packer coming from? I asked him.
Look at the tags,
he replied in a surly tone. Where in Virginia? I refused to be put off by him. It was Pleasance who said,
Tidewater area, ma'am. The Packer belongs to us. We got a lot of them we lease.
The landfill's administrative headquarters overlooked the fire pond and was quaintly out of sync with the loud, dusty surroundings. The building was pale peach stucco, with flowers in window boxes and sculpted shrubs bordering the walk. Shutters were painted cream, a brass pineapple knocker on the front door. Inside, I was greeted by clean, chilled air that was a wonderful relief, and I knew why investigator Percy Ring had chosen to conduct his interviews here. I bet he hadn't even been to the scene. He was in the break room, sitting with an older man in shirt sleeves, drinking Diet Coke and looking at computer-printed diagrams.
This is Dr. Scarpetta.
Sorry,
Pleasant said, adding to Ring,
I don't know your first name.
Ring gave me a big smile and a wink.
The doc and I go way back.
He was in a crisp blue suit, blonde and exuding pure youthful innocence that was easy to believe. But he had never fooled me. He was a big talking charmer who basically was lazy, and it hadn't escaped me that the moment he had become involved in these cases, we had been besieged by leaks to the press.
And this is Mr. Kitchen, Pleasance was saying to me, the owner of the landfill.
kitchen was simple in jeans and Timberland boots, his eyes gray and sad as he offered a big rough hand.
"Please sit down," he said, pulling out a chair. "This is a bad, bad day, especially for whoever that is out there."
"Well, that person's bad day happened earlier," Ring said. "Right now, she's feeling no pain."
"Have you been up there?" I asked him.
"I just got here about an hour ago, and this isn't the crime scene, just where the body ended up," he said.
"Number 5.
He peeled open a stick of juicy fruit.
"He's not waiting as long. Only 2 months in between them this time."
I felt the usual rush of irritation. Ring loved to jump to conclusions and voice them with the certainty of one who doesn't know enough to realize he could be wrong. In part, this was because he wanted results, without work.
"I haven't examined the body yet, or verified gender," I said, hoping he would remember there were other people in the room. "This isn't a good time to be making assumptions."
"Well, I'll leave you," Pleasant said nervously on his way out the door.
"I need you back in an hour so I can get your statement,"
Ring loudly reminded him. Kitchen was quiet, looking at diagrams, and then Grig walked in. He nodded at us and took a chair.
"I don't think it's an assumption to say that what we got here is a homicide," Ring said to me.
"That you can safely say," I held his gaze.
"And that it's just like the other ones."
"That you can't safely say. I haven't examined the body yet," I replied. Kitchen shifted uncomfortably in his chair.
"Anybody want a soda? Maybe a coffee?" he asked. "We got restrooms in the hall."
"Same thing," Ring said to me as if he knew. "Another torso in a landfill."
Grig was watching with no expression, restlessly tapping his notebook. Clicking his pen twice, he said to Ring,
"I agree with Dr. Scarpetta. Seems we shouldn't be connecting this case to anything yet, especially not publicly."
"Lord help me, I could do without that kind of publicity," Kitchen said, blowing out a deep breath. "You know, when you're in my business, you accept this can happen, especially when you're getting waste from places like New York, New Jersey, Chicago. But you never think it's going to land in your yard."
He looked at Grig.
"I'd like to offer a reward to help catch whoever did this terrible thing. $10,000 for information leading to the arrest."
"That's mighty generous," Grig said, impressed.
"That include investigators?"
Ring grinned.
"I don't care who solves it."
Kitchen wasn't smiling as he turned to me.
"Now you tell me what I can do to help you, ma'am."
"I understand you use a satellite tracking system," I said. "Is that what these diagrams are?"
"I was just explaining them,"
Kitchen said. He slid several of them to me. Their patterns of wavy lines looked like cross-sections of geode, and they were marked with coordinates.
"This is a picture of the landfill face. We can take it hourly, daily, weekly, whenever we want, to figure out where waste originated and where it was deposited. Locations on the map can be pinpointed by using these coordinates."
He tapped the paper.
"Sort of similar to how you plot a graph in geometry or algebra."
Looking up at me, he added, "I reckon you suffered through some of that in school."
"Suffer is the operative word," I smiled at him. "Then the point is, you can compare these pictures to see how the landfill's face changes from load to load." He nodded.
Yes, ma'am. That's it in a nutshell.
And what have you determined? He placed 8 maps side by side. The wavy lines in each were different, like different wrinkles on the face of the same person.
Each line, basically, is a depth, he said. So we can pretty much know which truck is responsible for which depth.
Ring emptied his Coke can and tossed it in the trash. He flipped through his notepad as if looking for something. This body couldn't have been buried deep, I said. It's very clean, considering the circumstances. There are no post-mortem injuries. And based on what I observed out there, the cats grab bales off the trucks, smash them open. They spread the trash on the ground so the compactor can doze it with a straight blade, chopping and compressing.
That's pretty much it.
Kitchen eyed me with interest.
You want a job?
I was preoccupied with images of earth-moving machines that looked like robotic dinosaurs. Claws biting into plastic-shrouded bales on trucks. I was intimately acquainted with the injuries in the earlier cases, with human remains crushed and mauled. Except for what the killer had done, this victim was intact.
Hard to find good women, Kitchen was saying. You ain't kidding, brother, Ring said as Grig watched him with growing disgust. Seems like a good point, Grig said. If that body had been on the ground for any time at all, it would be pretty chewed up.
The first 4 were, Ring said, mangled like cube steak. He eyed me.
This one look compacted?
The body doesn't appear crushed, I replied.
Now that's interesting too, he mused. Why wouldn't it be? It didn't start out at a transfer station where it was compacted and baled, Kitchen said. It started out in a dumpster that was emptied by the packer. And the packer doesn't pack?
Ring dramatically asked.
Thought that's why they were called packers.
He shrugged and grinned at me. It depends on where the body was in relation to the other garbage when the compacting was done, I said. It depends on a lot of things.
Or if it was compacted at all, depending on how full the truck was,
Kitchen said.
I'm thinking it was the packer. Or at most, one of the 2 trucks before it, if we're talking about the exact coordinates where the body was found.
I guess I'm going to need the names of those trucks and where they're from, Ring said.
We gotta interview the drivers. So you're looking at the drivers as suspects,
Grig said coolly to him.
Gotta give you credit. That's original. The way I look at it, the trash didn't originate with them. It originated with the folks who pitched it. And I expect one of those folks is who we need to find.
Ring stared at him, not the least bit perturbed.
I'd just like to hear what the drivers have to say. You never know. It'd be a good way to stage something. You dump a body in a place that's on your route and make sure you deliver it yourself. Or hell, you load it into your own truck. No one suspects you, right?
Grig pushed back his chair. He loosened his collar and worked his jaw as if it hurt. His neck popped, then his knuckles. Finally, he slapped his notebook down on the table and everybody looked at him as he glared at Ring.
You mind if I work this thing?
He said to the young investigator.
I'd sure hate not to do what the county hired me for. And I believe this is my case, not yours.
Just here to help, Ring said easily as he shrugged again.
I didn't know I needed help,
Grig replied.
The state police formed the multi-jurisdictional task force on homicides when the second torso showed up in a different county than the first one, Ring said. You're a little late in the game, good buddy. Seems like you might want some background from somebody who's not. But Greg had tuned him out, and he said to Kitchen,
I'd like that vehicle information, too.
How about I get it for the last five trucks that were up there to be safe? Kitchen said to all of us. That will help a lot, I said as I got up from the table. The sooner you could do that, the better.
What time you going to work on it tomorrow?
Ring asked me, remaining in his chair, as if there were little to do in life and so much time. Are you referring to the autopsy? I asked.
You bet.
I may not even open this one up for several days.
Why is that?
The most important part is the external examination. I will spend a very long time on that. I could see his interest fade. I'll need to go through trash, search for trace, degrease and deflesh bones, get with an entomologist on the age of the maggots to see if I can get an idea of when the body was dumped, etc.
Maybe it's better if you just let me know what you find, he decided.
Grig followed me out the door and was shaking his head as he said in his slow, quiet way,
When I got out of the army a long time ago, state police was what I wanted to be. I can't believe they got a bozo like that.
Fortunately, they're not all like him, I said. We walked out into the sun as the ambulance slowly made its way down the landfill in clouds of dust. Trucks were chugging in line and getting washed, as another layer of shredded modern America was added to the mountain. It was dark out when we reached our cars. Grig paused by mine, looking it over.
I wondered whose this was, he said with admiration. One of these days I'm going to drive something like that. Just once.
I smiled at him as I unlocked my door. Doesn't have the important things like a siren and lights. He laughed.
Marino and me are in the same bowling league. His team's the Balls of Fire. Mine's the Lucky Strikes. That old boy's about the worst sport I ever seen. Drinks beer and eats, then thinks everybody's cheating. He brought a girl the last time.
He shook his head.
She bowled like the damn Flintstones, dressed like them, too, in this leopard skin thing. All that was missing was a bone in her hair. Well, tell him we'll talk.
He walked off, his keys jingling. Detective Grig, thanks for your help, I said. He gave me a nod and climbed into his Caprice.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.